And cloud-native applications. It includes development of large applications for enterprise scale and web scale using industry models like insurance application architecture and information framework. Presently, it is part of the artificial intelligence program in TCS Digital Enterprise. Primary responsibilities of it include delivery of architecture focused on AI and building capabilities around shallow learning, deep learning, and natural language understanding. We are very much fortunate to have you, sir, as our today's resource person. Thank you for accepting our invitation and being part of this FTP. So now I'm going to hand over to resource person, Mr. Rajiv M. Azubut. Thank you, sir.
Thanks for the intro. So I'm not sure about the timing. Is this 3 hours session? Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So are we planning to take a break or something in between?
So it is a 2 hour session.
Okay.
2 to 4.
Okay. Sure. Okay. Yeah, I just want to be. So today's topic is going to be predominantly focused on deep learning because tomorrow we have a.
Sir, excuse me.
Yeah.
Sir, Rajeshwari here.
Yeah.
Sir, actually, we have 1.5 hours of session for now, and tomorrow another 1.5 hour session.
Yeah, sure. No problem. I will accordingly adjust that, you know.
Okay, sir. If you extend for another 15 minutes also, no problem, sir.
Yeah, sure,
Okay, sir. Yeah, thank you.
So I'm taking session from my mobile. So in case there is a disturbance, because I'm actually based out of Kochi, but I had to come to Palghat to meet my parents. So in case there is a disturbance, please let me know. You know, I can come back to that. So let me share my presentation so that please let me know once you are able to see my desktop, you know. So I've shared my presentation, like desktop. Are you able to see my desktop? Please let me know.
Yes, sir. It is visible, sir. It's very much visible. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So today's topic is going to be on AI. But before I touch on AI, I just want to give you intro onto the field itself. So you might have heard terminologies like digital 4.0, cognitive 4.0, and all, you know. So one of the biggest problem in this field is, you know, the terminologies are a little confusing. A lot of people doesn't know what's the difference between machine learning, data science, all those things, you know, because they have a lot of overlap in them. So that is the reason. So if you look at this diagram, this gives you what is called a subset of cognitive 4.0, which is part of what is called digital 4.0, you know. So that involves fields like edge computing, augmented intelligence, general intelligence, you know, deep symbolic intelligence. There are many areas. So today we will be touching a very, very small portion of this called, AI, which is will be focusing predominantly on machine learning and a subfield of machine learning called deep learning. So I will probably skip some of these areas. So if you look at the trends in data science today, you can see what are basically emerging. One is that, you know, we are seeing immutability of data by itself, you know. So the data is not getting immuted, which means we are constantly generating more and more data. And in this data, unstructured is gaining more traction. So mostly 80 to 85% of the data that we have today is actually unstructured data, you know. So we will come to a little bit detail as to what type of techniques are used in this type of processing unstructured data and stuff. And then one of the trend that you can see today is, today we achieve competence, machines achieve competence, but sometimes the problem with them is that they have very little comprehension of what they are doing. So classic example is, if you take chess, most of the chess programs today that exist can beat even the best chess player, but hardly these systems are able to detailedly explain as to what's happening here, you know, but they are able to beat you. So that's what I call as competence without comprehension, you know. So that you will see a lot in AI based systems. where the system is intelligent, but it's not intelligent in the sense how it's intelligent like a human being, you know. Then one of the trend that you can see is that there is a lot of proliferation of frameworks and toolkits. There are hundreds of frameworks and toolkits available in this field. So it's not a very easy for a student or a teacher to grasp this field that fast, you know. Then areas like blurring of business boundaries. So I will skip some of those things. So from a role perspective, when you come to industry, there are different roles that you play. That depends on your skill and what type of a thing. So all the way from data and big data engineer, where your main job is to basically process the data and stuff. Then you become an architect, you know, data architect, where you will see how to integrate multiple data coming from multiple systems in the organization. Data scientists typically model machine learning models. They create that. And data science managers are typically in the field of this one. Statisticians do build models. Again, like the data scientists, statisticians are actually, they build models, both shallow learning models and deep learning model. We'll cover deep learning today. Then there are job roles like machine learning or deep learning engineer, decision science, you know, full stack machine learning, deep learning engineer, researcher, hardware, you know, engineers, embedded software systems. So if you really look at that, there is a lot of jobs here. And the beauty of these jobs is that most of these jobs are interdisciplinary in nature. So when I say interdisciplinary in nature, if you want to work in machine learning, you have to have a combination of computer science skills, statistical skills, mathematical skills, and other skills like visualization and other skills as part of it. So if you look at our course curriculum, it is not being taught in a single unit. So a lot of jobs in the future are going to be interdisciplinary in nature, you know. So it's a good idea for faculty to start allowing students to computer science students to take courses from mathematics or from statistical department, because some of these areas, the knowledge that you need to have are cross-functional in nature, and hence you need to have so hardware engineer, you know, you need to be. If you want to become that, you know, you need to have a combination of computer science plus electronics background, you know. I'll skip this. I'm not going to go deeper into that. Now I'm going to get into the pure, like the machine learning aspect of it, which deep learning and machine learning aspect of it, which we will cover today. I'm going to cover the fundamentals only. We can go deeper if you have any questions or things like that, because it. Okay, so the first question comes is, you know, as I said, there are terminology problems. So what is difference between artificial intelligence and what is difference between artificial intelligence versus machine learning? You know, a lot of people have this question, you know, especially youngsters who have not been exposed to this. So artificial intelligence is the overarching name. One of the prominent fields in artificial intelligence is what is called machine learning. How do you make machines to learn, you know? Certain aspects of it, and deep learning is actually a subset of machine learning. So machine learning can be split into two, what is called statistical machine learning or what is called shallow machine learning. And then there is a field called deep learning, which is derived more in the way how our human brain works, you know. So we'll take a deeper look into that. Then where do we apply machine learning, you know? We can apply machine learning into many fields. We can apply it for natural languages. We can apply it for speech. We can apply it for planning, scheduling, and optimizations, mostly warehouses, you know, large warehouses like Amazon's and stuff. Robotics is another area where you know, the movements of robots, the actions they do, autonomous vehicles, where computer vision is used a lot. So how does a Tesla car drive without a driver, you know? Basically, it understands every object in and around it, and it understands the vehicle movements, paths, so many other things come to that. So all this field, if you look at that, machine learning forms the core of it, actually. But there are artificial intelligence is beyond machine learning. There are areas like expert systems and many other things that forms the core of that. But today, when you hear the term artificial intelligence, predominantly you are hearing machine learning. You know, so when a company says, you know, you have been given a job in the field of AI, they are predominantly talking with respect to machine learning. Actually, you know. Now this is just a simple diagram which depicts that AI is a larger field. Machine learning is a subfield within that. Deep learning is a subfield within machine learning. As I said, machine learning involves statistical machine learning, which or shallow learning plus deep learning. Actually, you know, so it's a subset of that. Actually, so this is just to give you an idea. So now, before we get into machine learning, let us first look at this. This is the difference between shallow learning and deep learning. But before we get into shallow learning or machine learning, what is the difference between a traditional program and a machine learning? You know, in a traditional program, you have an input, you have a logic. The data that is given as the input is processed by the logic to give you an output. That is what a traditional program is. So simple thing is that you are giving a number 2, you are getting a number output as 4. Probably that was because it was the number input was squared, you know. So the logic was nothing but to square the number. So it's 2 raised to 2, you get 4. You give 3, you get 9 out, you know. You give 4, you get 16 out. So that is what is traditional programming is all about. You have an input, you have a logic that gives you an output. So now, what is the difference with machine learning? Actually, in machine learning, you have an input and you have an output that you are expecting. The machine derives what is the logic that's required to that, you know. So just to give you an example, you are training a classifier. Classifiers are actually a type of algorithms in machine learning where it can classify certain objects of interest, you know. So if you take an autonomous vehicle, autonomous vehicles can segregate between cars, trucks. They can segregate between signals, whether it's a stop sign, whether it's a... So you train a system by giving an input and you are telling what type of an output it is. So you will train a system with showing 100 cars and you will tell that it is a car. So that tomorrow when you show another car, it is able to understand that this also looks like a car which I have been trained on. So you have an input. You are telling this is the output of it, and the logic by itself is derived actually. So that is what is called machine learning actually. So in the machine learning, that's the difference between traditional programming. So in traditional programming, you have an input, you have a logic, and that logic manipulates your input to give you an output. In machine learning, you have an input, you are telling what the input stands for. So you are telling what the output is, and the machine understands what is needed to basically do the job of given an input. How do I get to that output, you know? So just to give you an example, let us take the numbers 2. So I am training a machine learning algorithm where I give input as 2 and I'm getting an output as 4. I'm giving an input as 3, I'm getting an output as 9, you know. I'm showing the machine now 4. Output as 16. So now when you show a series of numbers as inputs and a series of numbers as outputs, over a period of time, the machine automatically understands the fact that here the logic that is applied is given number squared is the output of it. You know, it could be any complex function, and I just gave you a square as the function. So it's whatever we did was nothing but y is equal to x squared. So if x is 2, we get y to be 4. If x is 3, we get y to be 9. If x is 5, we get y to be 25. So the function here is y is equal to x squared. So it need not have to be that simple a function. It can be extremely complex functions. Given sufficient amount of inputs and sufficient amount of outputs, the system will try to understand the function that's applied to take an input to give an output, you know. So that's the difference. So then now the question comes is, what is the difference between shallow learning and deep learning? So the predominant difference between shallow learning and deep learning is in this field, there is something called feature extraction actually. So in a traditional machine learning, the feature extraction is done by human beings, but in deep learning, you don't have to do that. The system itself automatically do the feature extraction. So that's the main difference between traditional machine learning and deep learning actually. So you don't have to do that feature extraction. So feature extraction plus classification or regression, whatever is the type of algorithm that you are using, is part of the network itself actually. Do we want to stop for questions or do we want to wait till the end?
Sir, you can continue, sir. Questions will be at the end, sir.
Okay, thanks. So now coming to machine learning per se, there are different types of machine learning. So one is called supervised, one is called unsupervised, and then there is something called reinforced, and there are some more, but I'm not going to get into that. So the main difference is, in a supervised machine learning, typically a human teaches the machine with respect to certain aspect of it. So it could be the fact that we showed a few series of cars or buses and tell the machine that this is a car or this is a bus. So the tagging of data is done by the human being. So it could be classification or regression, either way. You show a house and you tell that this house cost 37 lakhs. You show another house and tell that this cost, 25 lakhs. So as part of showing the house, you give the location where the house is, how much square feet it is, what type of material is used in this house, whether it's a marble or is it a simple tile or is it a granite, So those aspects are trained by human beings. So that's why it's called a supervised system, So humans tell what is that output and how that output was derived to the system, In an unsupervised system, you have a large amount of data, just like how a human does and try to understand the data, he does segmentation of the data to understand it. So in unsupervised, you don't have tagging of data. So given a set of data, you will try to identify, either classify it yourself, given 100 images, you say that this 100 images falls into 10 categories, It could be dog images, it could be cat images or something like that. So a system also can do unsupervised, but there are limitations because in an unsupervised technique, I could give you a number like, let us say, I could give you 4, 9, 16 and other things. But you don't know how that number was formed actually because you have not told any aspect of it. You could divide the number 4, 9, 16 into different forms. To one way looking at is that 4, 9, 16 are nothing but squares of certain numbers, Or another way of looking at is it could be a prime number versus it could be a odd versus even number. So that type of a segmentation is difficult because given a data, you could see that data in multiple angles, that basic difference between supervised and unsupervised is, in unsupervised, you do not have any tagging of data. Reinforcement is a little different thing. Reinforcement learning is more like, how algorithms learn to react to an environment, predominantly in areas like gaming, and it's more like how a kid learns, So if a kid puts its hands onto something like a flame, it knows that it burns. So that next time it will not, so you have a candle which is lit. If the kid doesn't know that the candle, if it puts its hands onto that candle, it can burn his hand. First it will try it out, it will take its hand towards the candle, burning candle, and then it realizes that, it gets a reflex that, oh, it's hot. So next time onwards, it will not put its hand. So because it's basically it is reacting to an environment. So there are many. Robotics is a classic example where reinforcement learning is used, where the robot has to understand the environment it interacts with. So classic case could be, robots like Roomba, which are cleaning robots, So there are today cleaning robots, which you can leave it in your house. they go on cleaning the floor, you know. But if you have a cot or if you have a sofa set, you know, they will not go and hit them because they have sensors and stuff which can identify there is an obstruction in and around that, you know. So it's a different type of algorithms. But one thing you should understand is that today when people talk about machine learning, we are predominantly talking 60 to 70% we are talking about supervised learning, you know. Unsupervised and reinforcement are probably, you know, 10% or around that, but predominantly with more and more robotics coming into that, we'll be getting into reinforcement learning a lot, you know. So now coming to the, in order to do machine learning, what do we need? So there is something called trinity of AI. So obviously, any machine learning system needs data. So the data could be structured, data could be unstructured. So it could be images, it could be videos, voice, text. It could be structured in the sense that, you know, as I said, house prices, you know. So house prices. So you square foot, square feet could be one of the parameters. It could be the location of the place. So those are all structured data per se. So there are a lot of, so I would say that machine learning is more becoming commonly used with unstructured data. But 10 years back, this was not the case. So 10 years back, if you look, structured data was predominantly being used for machine learning. But today we are getting into a field where actually we are doing a lot of machine learning on unstructured data. This is very, very important because techniques differs. A technique used for structured data might not be ideal for something like images or voice. So it differs. So data is a very, very important component. So you can think of trinity of AI more like a three-legged stool, you know. So data forms one of the legs of that stool. Next is infrastructure, you know. So when you say infrastructure, how do I train my model? You know, where do I infer? So today, there are a lot of infrastructure available. So typically, all of us works with CPU systems, you know, central processing unit. You know, all our laptops do have CPUs, but some of our laptops do have GPUs also, graphical processing units. But there are many more hardwares like FPGA, field programmable gate arrays, ASICs. You know, ASICs are applications that are specific integrated circuits, like what you call TPU, you know, tensor processing units, vision processing units. And then IPUs, which is called intelligent processing units, OPUs and stuff. So typically in a computer science course, the max mostly they teach you are CPUs and GPUs, and few colleges might have electives in FPGAs, but in industry, when you come, you will end up working with a lot of these other hardwares also, actually. So data, infrastructure, and the next is algorithm. So we'll get a little more deeper into algorithms. So today, the focus will be on deep learning algorithms and stuff as we go. So algorithms, again, we have shallow learning and deep learning. And within deep learning, you have a lot of architectures. So we'll come to convolutional neural nets. CNN stands for convolutional neural nets. RNN stands for recurrent neural nets. You have transformers, autoencoders, GANs. So the type of algorithm that you choose to some extent depends on the data also. So if you see CNN is predominantly used for images, but that doesn't mean CNN cannot be used for text. You can use CNN for text also, but predominantly you don't tend to see them used, but typically you can use it. Similarly, transformer-based architectures. If you want, transformer-based architectures are predominantly used for text, but today they are used for images also. So I'm not going to go through this detail. So if you look at here, it's further splits machine learning into field of unsupervised. So within unsupervised learning, you know, what are that? You know, clustering is a classic example. So clustering, one example of clustering could be customer segmentation, you know. So a retailer has customers whose age is all the way from, you know, 5 years old to 0 years, probably just newborn babies to all the way till 98 or 100. they might cluster their products based on certain aspects, you know, teenage, you know, adolescent, you know, different types. So clustering customer segmentation and stuff, users do that. And then in unsupervised, there is another technique called dimensionality reduction, you know. So how do you reduce the dimension so that the computer systems are able to process? Because some of the problems, they cannot be solved with one machine, you know. You can't solve your problem in a laptop or even on a server, you know. So there are techniques called dimensionality reduction and all, in which it's more like you can think dimensionality reduction very close to how compression works, you know. So in a compression, you are compressing, let us say you take an image which was 1 MB. Now you apply a compression, you get 50 KB. The question comes is, what did I lose? Because if I reduced my image from 1 MB to 50 KB, what did I lose? So there are, you might have lost something, but the question is that loss justifiable enough? Because now you only have to store 50 KB and process 50 KB. But the outcome of that was for a classification, in which case that 1 megabyte image was not required. 50 KB was more than sufficient enough to determine whether it's a cat or a dog or something like that, you know. So dimensionality reduction is very similar to that, where you reduce the dimension of your input, but without losing much of its information, you know. So you compress something like into the order of 110 or 100, but the loss of information is in the range of 5% or 10%, you know. And then supervised, you have classification, regression, and reinforcement learning. I'm not going to go into this, but you can take a look at it later on. There are different areas. All these areas, you can use deep learning and you can use shallow learning also. Both can be applied. But then why do people today use deep learning? Because today we have a lot of data available. Earlier days, we never had this much data available because it was not digitized this much, you know. But today we have plenty of data. And when you have more data to train on, some of the deep learning algorithms actually outshine the shallow learning algorithms. But don't get me wrong, shallow learning algorithms are very, very useful still. And they're extremely good when you have lesser amount of data, you know. So if you look at the machine learning here, there are many linear regression, logistic regression. I'm not going to go into that. Nearest neighbor, decision trees. Some of these things you might be teaching in your course curriculum also as part of computer science. So SVM, you know, support vector machines, random forest. So all the top ones are deep learning machine, shallow learning algorithms. There is at the end, there is a class called artificial neural networks, you know. So they are the ones which we will be focusing today. And neural networks are modeled around our brain, but don't compare them to our brain. But our brain is much more powerful. But they are at least modeled around that. You can think about modeling an aircraft. Similar to, we would have modeled an aircraft similar to how a bird was, you know, but a bird is different and an aircraft is different, you know, but at least it is the mathematical equivalent. Aircraft is a mathematical equivalent of a bird, where it can fly, it can carry certain weight and do that. So neural networks are the mathematical equivalent of your brain. A brain is able to solve a problem. A neural network is also able to solve a problem, but how they solve is probably a little different. And each of them have their own advantages and disadvantages also, you know. So it's only a mathematical model. It need not have to be very close to each other. So now coming to machine learning, actually the field of machine learning is divided into 5 segments. I'm not going to go into each of them. So overall it's called symbolist, connectionist, evolutionaries, Bayesians, and analogizers, you know. So if you look at each of them and some algorithms in this space, whenever you apply logic, you know, logic, inverse deduction and things like that, it comes from the symbolist. Whenever you have connectionist, so neural networks and things like that, you know, where you use connectionist techniques like neural networks, it basically falls into connectionist. Then you have something like evolutionaries. So evolutionaries are where algorithms comes from the family of genetic algorithms, where you say that you know, all the next generations are mutations of existing. And now classic example which we can talk about is our virus, COVID-19, you know. So if you look at the newer variants of COVID-19, they are mutated variants of COVID-19 actually. So if you want to a little bit understand them and study about them, you know, genetic algorithms could be a good choice for that, you know. And then you have another two categories. One is called Bayesians. So Bayesians are actually, they work with probability. So you have posterior probability and then graphical models comes in that, you know. So many graphical models comes in this category of Bayesians, you know. Then you have analogizers. So where you have things like constraint optimizations and things like support vector machines, where you convert your problem from one space into another space, higher dimensional space, and then you solve. See, in dimensionality reduction, we talked about reducing the dimension, but in case of algorithms like support vector machines, you move your problem from one dimension to a higher dimension, you know, to solve that. Because what is not linearly separable in a lower dimension might be linearly separable in a higher dimension. So I will give you a classic example. Think about two circles where one you have an inner circle and then you have an outer circle. Let us say you have points on the inner circle and you have points on the outer circle. You want to differentiate these two points, you know. So if you look at circle, it is not easily separable by itself through linearly, you know. But one thing you can do is that instead of circle, you can take the radius. So when you take the radius, you still can separate that. So what you did is that you moved the problem from one dimension to another, actually. So support vector machines typically do that. They map the problem in a higher dimensional space so that you can solve the problem by linearly separating it, you know. So I'm not going to go into deeper into that, but this is in all of this, you have hundreds and hundreds of algorithms available in all this field. So we will look at connectionist, which is actually neural networks, you know. I'm not going into the I talked about the interdisciplinary nature of that. So typically, if you have to be good in this field, you need to have a sufficiently enough knowledge in statistics, physics, information theory, signal processing, neuroscience, and optimization theory. So if you have to churn out students who are extremely good in the field of machine learning, they better have to have this interdisciplinary nature, because that is what is going to define them, how they solve a problem, you know, how well they can solve a problem, you know. So if you look at this slide, it is actually not purely computer science. It is actually a mixture of skills. So this is one of the reasons that many colleges today, I'm part of around 5 board of studies actually. So today, if you see some of the colleges where I am part of it, they have a dedicated BTech program in artificial intelligence, actually, which is actually an interdisciplinary field. So they have faculty from computer science, they have faculty from statistics department or mathematics department, they have faculty from, you know, mathematics optimizations and stuff, then a few from electronics, you know, information theory and stuff, and then neuroscience, typically we don't go deeper into that, but you still can have that, and then signal processing and stuff. So it is very, very important to understand this fact that computer science by alone is not sufficient here. It is an interdisciplinary skill, and this is one of the reasons that many colleges have started doing the BTech program in artificial intelligence. Rather than teaching them purely computer science and then they come to industry and slowly adapt to AI, now they are trained itself in the field of AI at the school level. So they will get a BTech or a master's degree in artificial intelligence, you know, with focus to machine learning or some field like that. So if you look at the ML maturity in business problems today, it is reasonably matured in image processing, text But there are many areas like, you know, adversarial training, reinforcement learning, robotics and all, where it's even in image processing, it is not perfect, but it is little more matured than other areas like, you know, question answering and others, you know. So slowly, I would say that it is improving, but we never know. There's nothing called perfection here, you know. Even after 20 years, we'll be further improving upon the way we do things, you know. So this is the maturity model at present, you know. So please don't get confused saying that, you know, image processing, we are completely matured. The answer is no. What this slide tries to communicate is that image processing is little more matured than reinforcement learning. That's all this slide communicates. Now coming to the machine learning ecosystem, for a student to work, you know, we talked about what do we need. We need data, we need a set of hardware, we have a series of algorithms of interest. So now in order to do this, you know, I need to know a programming language, I need to use certain frameworks to do this, and I need to have a set of hardware available either on premise or on cloud and do that. So if you look at the machine learning ecosystem, programming and frameworks, I would say Python is the most prominent framework today used, but there are other frameworks like R, Java, Julia and all, which you can use it for do that. So typically you will see some of the colleges teaching Python, some of the colleges teaching R, but if your focus is on machine learning, I would say Python is more prominently used than R actually today, but R has a lot of useful stuff, so don't get me wrong. If you are able to learn both Python and R, excellent. But if you are only planning to learn one programming language, I would say Python might be more beneficial to you. And once you choose Python, there are many libraries within Python called NumPy, Pandas. I am not going to go deeper into that. SciPy, scikit-learn, matplotlib, you know, to plot your data and stuff, you know, you can use matplotlib. Scikit-learn is a package which implements many algorithms which you use. NumPy is an array. It's an array format, and Pandas is what is called data frame. So if you have structured data and if you want to treat them more like a table, you know, you use what is called Pandas actually. So coming to DL frameworks, so DL frameworks by itself, if you look at that, there are many frameworks. I would say the most prominent two of them today that exist are TensorFlow and PyTorch. But there are other frameworks like FA, MXNet, Spark, Apache Spark. If you want to do distributed machine learning, you'll go for Apache Spark or H2O. Then there are commercial vendors like SAS, who has their own stuff, SAS, MATLAB. So you guys might be more familiar with MATLAB because many colleges use MATLAB for the purpose. So MATLAB implements a lot of algorithms, deep learning algorithms and shallow learning algorithms. So you can use MATLAB also. But why industry does not use MATLAB is that it is a commercial product. So if I use TensorFlow or if I use PyTorch, I don't have to use any royalty for using the software. The software is free. But whereas if you use something like MATLAB, you'll have to pay for the company. So that's the main difference. And then coming to the hardware, where do I get the hardware for training and inference, you know, training and machine learning, this one. So that is available, either you can use cloud-based infrastructure. There are different clouds. There are generic clouds like Amazon, Azure, GCP, you know, Google compute platforms, IBM. And then there are some ML cloud available like DataRobot, DataIQ and stuff. Or if you have a lab in your college, you can use the lab machines with a GPU and stuff to basically train the machine learning models also. So that is predominantly called on-premise, you know. So you have your hardware on-premise, you know, but you don't have to use that. You can always use a cloud, but you'll have to pay for it, you know, if you want to use it. Yeah. So this is the typical traditional representation of, you know, you have data coming in, you have a data representation, you have deep learning, and you have a response output. You know, response could be classification, clustering, it could be anything. Okay. So now, why, even though we are talking a lot about machine learning and stuff, the question comes is, why is it still not heavily used in the enterprises, you know, because there are a lot of challenges. So speed is a challenge, power is a challenge. So if you look at today, your cell phone, if you see your cell phone, you have many machine learning models that are running in the cell phone. So when you type in WhatsApp, when you type something, you get what is called suggestions of words. What should be the next word? I am doing, if you are given a sentence like I am doing, what is the next word that is a high probability? Actually, I am doing fine could be that, you know, I am doing some activity could be the sentence, you know, so that prediction itself is a machine learning model. So in devices like mobile, it's very important that you don't consume more power, because if you consume more power, your battery will get drained very fast. So you have to be little bit power. So speed, power, accuracy, there are many challenges. So algorithmically, the challenges includes, you know, improving representation power, you know, non-convex optimization, you know, because many practical problems are way complex actually. So in an optimization, there's something called non-convex optimization, you know, I'm not going to get into that. You need to then minimizing generalization errors. So the question is, how do we know the machine learned it properly? You know, so there is no easy measurement for generalization today, even though we have accuracy and other metrics, but they are not perfect per se. You know, I'm not going to go into each of these. You can take a look at it later on. So implementation challenges, again, training time. So there are models which can run for days together on a cluster of machines, like 1024 machines, you know, where it can take, if you are training on, let us say, if you are training on 10,000 hours of voice data, you know, you are training on 10,000 hours of voice data means that can run for a week, 7 days. With 1024 machines, so that much of training time and power consumption it's required, you know. So just to give you a background, today for training a GPT-3 model, it takes millions of dollars. So that's why it's not every company can do it. The companies like Google and others do that because they have that power to do that, you know. I'm not going to go each and everything, so we'll skip. So now we are getting into deep learning per se, you know, so we'll focus on deep learning. So as I said, there are different frameworks. So there are deep learning frameworks which are imperative or symbolic. So among each of them, in imperative, PyTorch is the most famous one. And in the symbolic field, you know, TensorFlow is better, but there are other frameworks also available. So I'm not sure whether colleges teach today PyTorch and TensorFlow, but foundationally, if you look at that, Python is the programming language of choice. So both the frameworks, they are core written in C++, but you have Python API to interact with them, you know, because most of the machine learning libraries are written in C++ for speed of execution. But what people tend to do is that they give a Python API. So but when you call the Python API behind the scene, they are calling C++ functions, you know. So now coming to the task, so we said that, you know, deep learning could be used for many, many purposes. So it could be used for computer vision. It could be used for, conversion of voice to text or conversion of text to voice. It could be used for natural language processing, you know, summarization of a document. It could be used for question and answering. So what you use deep learning for differs a lot. You can use it for many purposes. So this is an example for computer vision. So in computer vision, there are different tasks. So if you look at the first one, it is called classification. Is this a cat or is this a dog? And we all know that it's a cat. So that's the simplest case. Then the next thing is that, where is this cat present? So this cat is present somewhere in the middle of that image, you know, that's why that square box defines, you know. So that's what classification plus localization, you know. So let us say you are asking a question, is this cat going to jump into water? So if it was sitting on a bridge, you know, So then you know that if it's sitting on the bridge, probably if it's closer to the edge of the bridge, it might jump onto the water, you know. So localization is important to understand where is this object present in the image and what is its alignment with other objects. The next is object detection. So where multiple objects are seen. So when an autonomous car goes through a road, it detects other cars in the road. It detects the road by itself. It knows which is the way the road is going. It detects signals on the pathway. It detects many other things, like whether there's there's a hole on the road, and it can detect many other aspects to understand whether. So that is typically comes under the category of object detection. And then there is something called segmentation. It's an extension of object detection where the exact boundary is determined. The exact boundary. So the dog's exact boundary, instead of a rectangle or a square box, it will now do what is called pixel based segmentation, you know. So it can do an instant segmentation with respect to that. So this is a simple example of computer vision. So similarly, you can think where the deep learning is used in terms of natural language processing. As I said, in natural language processing, one could be entity recognition, you know, entity extraction and recognition could be one aspect. So given a large corpus of text, you could say that, you know, find all people's name, you know, find all the people's name in this, or you could say that, you know, find all the places that exist in this text, you know, things like that. So that could be one aspect of it. It could be sentiment analysis. You have a textual communication, more like a WhatsApp. You can understand whether people are happy, unhappy, what they are doing. So what's called sentiment analysis, you know, typically used by product companies. So if you go to the social media platforms of product companies and you say that, you know, I purchased this camera and I'm not that happy with the camera. They know the fact that you are one of their customers and they are not happy with your product, you know. So that is what is called sentiment analysis on text and stuff. It could be other things like document summarization or article summarizations, you know. You have a large article, which is a 50-page article, but you want a one-page summary of that article, you know. How does a human reads the entire 50 page and comes up with a small summary of that, you know? So that is one aspect of its summary. So there are many such tasks. I'm not going to go into deeper of that, but nevertheless. So this is a very, very important slide, because when we are building a home, there are something called smaller components. So the house you build has many smaller components, isn't it? It has a foundation, it has a basement, it has walls, it has windows, it has a roof, it has a lintel. So it has so many components. So I am able to, if I say 10 architects, you know, I need a house of 1,200 square feet, all the 10 of them will come up with different plan, because what they understand is they understand the basic components. So they mix and match the basic components. One might put the window on the middle of the wall. Another might prefer to have two windows at the edge of the walls, you know. So there are different ways you combine to get a house, you know. So you can think neural networks in the same way. There are many basic components for a neural network. You can assemble them in different orders to get different neural networks and topologies, you know. So we'll get to that. So what are these basic components in a neural network, you know? So obviously neurons forms one of the core. Then you have other things like, you know, what type of a cost function do I need, you know? So typically in a house, what could be that your criteria for saying this house is a successful house, you know? So the one house owner might say that, you know, I have only 20 lakh budget. So you cannot build a house to be of 50 lakhs because I cannot afford to do that. Another might say that, you know, I'm fine with the cost of the house. I can go for little extra, but I would like it to look extremely good from outside and I have a better working functions inside, you know, I want the rooms to be. So similarly, a neural network can have cost functions of its own. So it differs. And then there are, since you have neurons and stuff, you have to initialize the weights. There's something called weight initialization. There are different algorithms for weight initialization. And then all machine learning problems, you can think them to be an optimization. So you want to optimize them. You want to minimize a function or you want to maximize a function, you know. So there are many other parameters for optimizations. So especially, as I said, whether you optimize a convex function or a you know, non-convex function, you have many things like learning rate, batch size, you know, different techniques like, you know, first order techniques, second order techniques and all, you know. So for optimization, because none of these problems have a closed form solution. So when you don't have a closed form solution, you have to use approximations, you know. So you have to use either first order approximations or second order approximations. Then you know, things like how to avoid overfitting. Overfitting is a case where you trained a neural network, it actually by-hearted the data. So this you can think more like how students learn, you know. Some students learn from the book, they by heart. When they by heart, what is the problem? If the teacher put the exam differently, not from the textbook, they are not able to generalize. So they will fail actually. So because the reason is that they have rather by-hearted the textbook. So there are techniques for reducing overfitting. So overfitting is very similar to that, where your algorithm performs extremely well on your data, but now when the algorithm is taken for evaluation with respect to public data, it fails. One example I could give you is that there was a company which trained on detecting humans, faces of humans. So it was trained on American data of American people, and it was taken to African population and Japanese, you know, it started failing. So in that case, the data was not sufficient, and added to that, it did an extremely overfitting on the type of data that was given to it, you know. And then layers like dense layers, flattened layers, pooling. So convolutions, there are 1D convolution, 2D convolution. So I'm not going to go into each of this. So but understand that these are the building blocks. These building blocks, you can combine them in different form to get different outputs, you know. And this is exactly what you do on a house actually. So as I said, if you give a house to 10 different architects, all the 10 will come up with 10 different houses, you know. So based on the criteria you gave. So similarly, you can assemble a neural network similar to that. So that this is where experience is very, very important. Am I doing something wrong by combining things which are not correct, you know? So that you learn over a period of time. I'm not going to go into each of this. Then there is something called data augmentation techniques. Because typically some of the algorithms do not understand orientation and all. So orientation means if you show a kid, let us say somebody's photo, now you rotate the photo into 180 degrees, you reverse that, but that kid will not get confused. So there is something called invariance. Humans are extremely good at, you know, things like rotational invariance, scaling invariance. So scaling invariance is a case where you saw a car within a range of 2 meters. Now you see a car from 100 meters away. So you are seeing only a spot on your eye, but you still know that that's a car coming from 100 meters away, you know. So what is called scaling invariance, you know. So you are not rotational invariance, scaling invariance. Humans don't get confused, you know. So color invariance. So color invariance is a case where you show someone's color photo and someone's black and white photo, we don't get confused. We exactly know this is person XYZ, you know. I don't have to see it on the color itself. I can still see it using a black and white. So typically algorithms don't understand this much actually. So that is why they are trained with variations actually, you know. You have to train them with variation. So you have to train the algorithm with both color images and black and white images actually of the same image, you know. you have to show them a person standing straight and probably that rotated image also, so that it knows it is still a person with a rotational or a portion of a car, you know. So if you look at the tail light of a car, and if you are only shown the tail light, most of the human being will tell that, you know, this looks like a tail light of a car, even though you have not seen the car per se, you know. So even a cropped portion will let you know. So algorithms are not that extremely intelligent. So they have to be trained on that. And then error correction, like how do we correct the errors on a neural network and stuff, you know, things like back propagation and stuff. I don't know whether I should go through that. This is a simplest neural network. You have a series of inputs, and you have a series of weight, and you have a weighted sum which gives you an output, you know. So a series of such layers. So we'll get into that little more complex function. So this is a little more complex diagram of the previous one, where you have an input layer, you have two hidden layers here, and you have an output layer. So I can have n number of hidden layers. There are systems with 200 hidden layers and 300 hidden layers, you know. So the more hidden layers you have, the system is able to learn more complex non-linear functions, you know. So non-linear functions, you know, so a linear function could be y is equal to mx plus c. Extremely non-linear function could be, you know, y is equal to, you know, sine x cube plus, you know, log of, you know, z plus something, you know, which is very complex non-linear function. So the more hidden layers you add, you can learn the more. And then the output, what do you expect in the output, you know? I'm expecting the output to be a numerical value, or I'm expecting it to be a class. It's a car or a bike or something, you know, or it could be a numerical value, like, you know, the price of a house or the price of a share, you know. So the output should be different. And there is another architecture in which the input and output will remain the same, and intermediate representation learned will be through the hidden layers. So it's called autoencoders. So autoencoders are used to transform an input to an output which is also same as input, but in such a way that you know, reconstruction will basically ensure that the hidden layers learn a different intermediate representation, you know. This is another more complex one. This is with respect to time. So if we really look at that, we are solving problems in different dimensions. So time could be a dimension, space could be a dimension, and other parameters could be different dimensions. So this is a time dimension. So that's why you see t minus 1, because some problem you require this, you need a time dimension. So one example could be that, you know, if you want to determine if somebody was fighting in a scene, you know, you can't look at a single image. You need a series of images to determine what type of activity they are doing. You know? So time is important there, actually, and the output is there. So if you look at the deep learning topologies, this is for computer vision. So if you look at that, there are different topologies. I'm not going to go into this because most of you might not understand it. So. Okay, then there is something called pre-trained models and transfer learning. So a human learns by transferring his knowledge. So I'll give you this concept, and so today's neural networks can learn like that. So if you look at what is transfer learning, you know, I learned something and I use that knowledge to further learn on something, you know. One classic example is let us say I was in India. So I learned about how the roads works, how the cars works and stuff. Now I'm taken to a country like US, where when I go, I already know how certain things works. So I try to adapt. What I do is I verify whether what I saw in India is same thing happening in US, you know. If not, I will recorrect my stuff. So it's, transfer learning is very similar to that. I take the knowledge from one area and transfer it to another area, actually, you know. One example could be that I learned a model for translating from English to French. That model weights could be used for transferring German to, German to Spanish also. No? So in which case you are transferring the knowledge from one task to another task. Now I am going to show some case studies on the manufacturing. It need not have to be manufacturing. It could be any area. So if you see today, AI is used in manufacturing, transportation, logistics. It's used in retail. So many life sciences. So even the COVID-19 vaccine. How are we able to manufacture a vaccine in less than 1 year? It's amazing. There is so much of work that has gone in. Where the AI is used in determining what type of chemical compositions these drugs needs to have, So it's a field called drug discovery. It's a very big field. So you can discover the drugs for a certain problem, and then. So in the manufacturing, you have many aspects. So product life cycles, logistics, product design. Process controls, whether it's meeting certain quality controls and stuff. Then you have remote diagnostics, maintenance, and stuff like that. There are so many areas. I'm not going to cover each of them, but you can take. There are some examples which are shown, but please don't get confused. I'm showing only manufacturing, but it is the field of deep learning and the machine learning is applied in many areas actually. So this is a classic case where when you do welding, there is something called defects in weld. So the welding could be applied on a garage. The welding could be even railway line welding. So between two railway lines you weld. That's how you weld two railway lines. Railway tracks. So there could be defects, and the defects in a weld are not great idea because let us say you have a steel structure, you have a home built of steel instead of concrete. So when you use steel for building a home instead of concrete, you have to weld them or you have to rubber them. So when you do welding, the problem with welds is that there could be vacuum inside the weld which will reduce the strength of that weld and cause a failure to happen in that weld. So this is the technique where they use during the welding. This equipment, it has a very powerful microphone, So during the welding, they get the sound, they capture the sound, and analyzing the sound, they tell whether there was a defect in that weld at certain point or not. Because if it is continuously welded and there was no defect in that, it has a sound generated which is unique versus a weld which is generating a noise, And another example I saw is that it's not from the manufacturing. Another example I saw with one of the doctors is that the doctors use stethoscopes to understand the sound inside your body, So when they use that, they can actually, from that sound, they can understand whether you have coughing or something, without you coughing itself. Actually, the way there are certain powerful stethoscopes today which use AI to say to the doctor that this person might be suffering from some cough related stuff, things like that, So what it does is it analyzes the sound, then for cases like noise cancelling. So when I'm talking to you on the phone, like over the microphone, if a auto or a car goes through by my house, you will hear that sound, But today there are microphones which does have noise cancelling and remove any noise other than my noise, It's very powerful. So they use techniques like AI for noise cancellation and stuff like that, So there are many such examples. I'm just trying to give you some example so that you can correlate this field, So this noise-based detection can be even applied to 3D printing and others, So there are today 3D printers which are metallic in nature. So you can print a metal using the 3D. printers, and if there is a defect in that metal, you know, you can detect that through this acoustic, and this is called acoustic analytics actually. So it's a field. This is that lung sound I was talking, you know, amplify heart and lung sounds. It's called IUC. You can take a look at it. These products are available in the market already. And detecting anomalies, you know, so anomalies are points which should not have happened, but somehow happened, you know, and you don't know what is the reason why they happened, you know. It can happen in manufacturing, you know, okay, so here, looking at that, you know, signals, you can tell that there is an anomaly here at certain point, you know, and things like that. Yeah, this is for predictive maintenance, you know, to determine when a machine will fail. So one of the classic examples for this is if you own a car. If you own a car, every 6 months you are car agency will call you saying that, you know, it is time for service. Please bring your car. You are been 6 months. So we do servicing today based on time. So every 6 months we take our car, we change the oil, and we do certain stuff. But predictive maintenance is used for more costly equipments where you don't cycle them every consistent fashion. You look at the sensor outputs, you know. So you look at when your car is driving, you know, it's not giving any vibration or something. So I really don't have to change my oil, you know. So it's not a time bound. So it will predict when a service is required, when it is going to fail, when you should replace parts and stuff like that, you know. So it's a field called predictive maintenance. Then shop floor optimizations and stuff, you know. So this is where you have a floor which you want to optimize. You have the data and how you go about doing it, things like that. I'm not going to go into the methodology per se. There is a lot of methodologies that you have to understand in order to do that, you know. This is another example of, you know, safety, hard hat detection. If you are on a construction site, it can alert the chief engineer to say that, you know, a couple of people on your site are not wearing a hard hat, you know. Hard hat is very, very important in many construction sites. Especially in foreign countries, they mandate. Actually, if it is not there and if something happens to that employee, the company is liable for paying the loss. So hard hat detection. So this is a case where, you know, human pose estimation, you know, you can estimate the pose of the person. Very, very important on shop floors, you know, whether you are doing some activity which can hurt you or which can hurt others, you know. So looking at the pose estimation and stuff, you can determine what to do. Are you on a place which is dangerous, and are you following the standards of doing that, things like that, you know, safety floor estimation and stuff. So you can take a look at then the quality control, you know, visual inspection, things like that, you know, building materials, you know, whether you have scratch on your materials and stuff. This is a case where, you know, visual inspection is used for detecting cracks on bottles, you know. So if you see the bottles which are made, they are all made in automated fashion. So today, mostly it is manual quality control. So when you have a manual quality control, somebody is sitting there and physically watching these bottles to see whether they have a crack or not. So now we use computer vision techniques to do this. A powerful camera which is kept can look at the bottle and determine whether there are cracks present or things like that, you know. So in this, there's a crack if you look at that bottle. So if you look at here, there's a crack here actually, which the system can determine and basically ensure that the bottle is removed from that lot, you know. This is the example of that. So it's a very high speed, high resolution and high speed camera which can monitor the. So in this case, if you look at that, the liquid is not filled fully. So if this was up to 100 ml, so this is actually missing like a couple of mls, you know, here. which is very important from a quality perspective. So when you are buying 100 ml coconut oil and you are only getting 98 ml, you know, so you are not getting 2 ml additional, you can theoretically sue that company actually. So they don't want that to happen. So they use computer vision to determine this, to see that actually, you know. So in this case, you can clearly see that it is missing few mls here. Then tablet manufacturing, you know. So look at these examples. So look at this tablet. A portion of this tablet is missing here. So when it goes through the conveyor belt, it can determine. And this typically happens because when your mold gets bad, some of the tablets, they don't have the edge and all. So the edge gets cut. So if you look at here, the edge is not there, you know. Capping and lamination is happening. So the tablet is a layered tablet. So it's actually splitting into different portions, you know. So things like that. See here, erosion has happened on the tablet, you know. Yeah, I will probably, there are some more things which I can cover actually. So I think I would stop here, and we have covered around 1 hour and 10 minutes. So I will take some questions and then see whether we want to further go deeper into this, you know. Hello, are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah. So we will take some questions and then we will further expand on it, you know, because I don't want to give too much of theory, you know.
Any query, kindly put it in the chat box or you can directly interact with us.
Yeah, I would say better to talk. I can watch the chat box also, but I would say better whoever wants to raise the question, you know, through the phone, it's easier, you know. I don't know whether all these folks who are attending have a background, because I know this conference was a 5-day conference or something, so I'm assuming you have a lot of background on this field, you know.
Yes, sir. A few have worked on this and few are new to this area.
Okay.
Most of them are faculty members and a few postgraduate scholars.
Okay.
Participants, any queries? You can please unmute and ask.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, please go ahead.
For mathematics faculty, please suggest the recent research area, sir.
Yeah, mathematics, see.
In AI, sir.
Yeah, that's what. So many, I would say optimization is one of the most, because if you see today, we use algorithms like stochastic gradient descent and all for, you know, doing the optimization, you know. As I said, non-convex optimization is a very large field, you know. So there is a lot of work that is happening in that field. Then another field is graph theory, you know. So I did not talk about graph theory here much, but a lot of problems are solved using graphs.
Okay, sir.
So graph theory is one of them, and numerical optimization is one of them. Even neural network, the activation functions used in the neural network are also improving, you know.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Should I continue with additional materials or I don't know whether the crowd is not able to understand what I am talking, you know?
Yes, sir, we can understand, sir.
Okay.
Sir, your presentation is very nice, sir. Actually, from 2 o'clock to till now, we are hearing your subject also.
Okay.
So, thank you, sir.
Yeah, no problem.
Good afternoon, sir. One question.
Yeah.
Sir, for DL and ML, does supervised learning covers both supervised, unsupervised, both covers both, or is it like means I just wanted to get a relation between supervised and DLML versus unsupervised DLML?
Yeah, you can have, as I said, you know, machine learning, there are different classifications possible. So when you look at the algorithm, the classification will fall into what is called shallow machine learning and deep machine learning, you know. So that is where shallow ML or statistical machine learning, some people call it as SML, statistical machine learning versus deep learning. So that is one way of looking at the problem. But AI by itself, machine learning problems are divided into supervised, unsupervised, and reinforcement learning. So I can use either of the algorithms in all the three cases, you know.
Okay, so there is no such like DL will only use unsupervised.
No. You can use both for both of them.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, there is a query, and Mohan sir, can you please mute yourself, sir? There is a bit of disturbance. Sir, there is a query from Mr. Praveen Kulkarni. He states that he is from mechanical domain, and he has got a faulty machine, okay, with the vibration signal. So can he apply machine learning? How to start with that?
Absolutely, he can do that. So what they do is that they typically collect the signals during the when the machine is working properly, you know.
Okay.
So that forms the training data for it actually. So whenever now the vibration or other parameters starts increasing, he can know, he can put a, what is called a lower bound threshold and an upper bound threshold, you know. So he can say that the vibration should vary within, because why this is done is typically if you see machines do have a upper bound and a lower bound, but those upper bounds and lower bounds are typically decided ahead of time. You know, you say that if the vibration crosses certain x value, please alert that, but that will not work because vibration is in turn related to other parameters like temperature, pressure and all, you know. So classic example is a case where, you know, where we can't have a fixed set of values for things like that, you know. So I would say that what he will have to do is he will have to measure his machine with respect to when it is working in good conditions, and based on that he can derive later on if it is varying with respect to any parameter. It need not have to be vibration itself. It could be if it is a machine which generates temperature, it could be temperature also, you know, temperature, pressure and stuff like that. He can determine that it is not behaving properly, you know. Yeah, today it's used a lot actually. In practice, it's used a lot. I hope I clarified what was being asked, you know. Okay, I see.
So there is one more question.
Yeah, go ahead.
By Rajeshwari Devi madam, that how do we decide the number of layers required in deep learning for face recognition?
Yeah, that is a very, very complex. It's a research topic because there is no easy way to tell whether I need a. So the question is, First of all, let us understand what is the problem having lesser number of layers and what is the problem having more number of layers. So when you have lesser number of layers, your system will not be able to learn. But when you have more number of layers, the system starts by-hearting it. As I said, it will do what is called overfitting. So what is the right number of layers? Actually, the answer is there is no simple way to figure that out. So it's a compromise between, you'll have to try different models to see which is generalizing well enough, you know. So that is why a lot of new layers are the research outcome of some researchers for months together. So they evaluate the model for months, probably years together before they publish the outcomes, you know. So the answer is that there is no easy way to tell that. But what you have to understand is, if you use less number of layers, you will not generalize well enough or you will not learn it. But if you use more number of layers, you will get into overfitting, you know.
Okay, right, sir. So thank you so much. Any queries, any further queries, participant?
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon, sir.
I'm having one query.
Yeah.
Actually, I just started with the deal with the TensorFlow, sir.
Yes.
But when I was searching, I could see many problems were solved using PyTorch. Is there anything like PyTorch is higher version, or I can just I just want to clear that if I can come, I can just continue with the flow, or I just want to move to PyTorch like that. I just want to ask.
No, you can continue with, so TensorFlow and PyTorch are two competing frameworks, you know. So you can, whatever you can achieve in PyTorch, you can achieve in TensorFlow and vice versa, you know.
Okay, sir. So the if I want to implement something in TensorFlow, the same thing could be done using a PyTorch, you're saying?
Yes. So let us say one researcher used and he codified his algorithm using PyTorch, and you only have the source code for that, you know. You can yourself convert that into TensorFlow. Many researchers have done that actually. If you are more familiar with that, they take the, so you have a transformer network which somebody has done it in PyTorch, they can rewrite that in TensorFlow. But you'll have to spend some effort.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Any further queries by the audience, by the participants? Thank you, sir. Thank you, Rajiv, sir. It was a wonderful session. You elaborated us into the case studies of the deep learning, machine learning, and the artificial intelligence. It was a nice go through. Thank you so much, sir. Let us join once again tomorrow morning for the continuation of the session. So thank you once again.
Yeah,
thank you,
participants. Before I close, I want to show you, so you can take it. I will put this link actually.
Okay,
so
sir.
I did not go through all the topologies. So if you go to this website, see the amount of, as I said,
yeah,
when you have a building block, when you have a series of building blocks, every house that you see today are built differently, isn't it? Because you have assembled the building blocks differently, you know. So this is a website, probably let me put it in the chat, which you can take. So many new architectures are also coming. So I put it in the chat. So you can look at that, you know, basic perceptron, you have feed forward networks, you have radial basis function based stuff, you have recurrent neural networks, RNN, LSTMs, GRU, what is called gated recurrent unit, autoencoders. So it's a huge family. So there are around thousands plus actually. So the question comes is, someone asked me, what is the easy way to understand whether I should have 4 layers or 6 layers? See, there is no easy answer, and there is no easy answer also whether should I use RNN or LSTM. There are some guidelines, but nevertheless, we can use CNN for even text. But there are some cases where CNN works actually better for text. But that is the experience that you have to gain working in problems, you know. So I would say read through this site, you will get more details on that. And if you want more materials, I can share based on your interest, you know.
Sure, sir. So thank you for posting the link. Hope participants will want to go through the link, sir. So will you be able to share the PPT, sir?
Yeah, the presentation, yeah, I can share it. I just probably will have to, once I go back home to Kochi, when I have a better internet, I'll probably send it to you, actually. No, no, not a problem.
Okay, sir. So thank you so much. Thank you for your support, sir.
Yeah, it so was tomorrow a morning, is it 9 o'clock?
It's 10 o'clock, sir. It's at 10 o'clock. The session okay. starts at 10 o'clock.
Okay, so tomorrow we will be covering PyTorch. So if you are from something like TensorFlow background, it's not a big problem, but I will be rather using a framework called PyTorch, which is very similar to TensorFlow, but it is a different. So if you see, TensorFlow is from Google, whereas PyTorch is from Facebook. Yeah, but we'll take a look at it. So we'll go through some of the Jupyter notebooks. So I don't know whether people are familiar with Jupyter notebooks, you know.
So there is one more query, excuse me.
Yeah.
So please, from yeah. Praveen Kulkarni, stating that SVMs versus cluster KNN, how to decide the algorithm?
Yeah, so if you really look at the algorithm per se is decided based on many aspects. So one criteria for algorithm selection is whether you have more data or you have lesser data, you know. The second aspect could be that whether the data forms a highly nonlinear space or is it more on a linear dimension, you know, the data correlations and stuff. Third aspect could be the fact that, you know, whether I want a explanation for my outcome. So some of the algorithms can, like if you go for CART is actually classification and regression trees. So CART like of thing, you can explain how you have achieved an outcome, you know. So you can explain to another person that, you know, I have achieved the outcome because if you look at the CART, it is more like rules, you know. So it's more like rules. It will tell you that I took up this to say that this is cat because, you know, it has two eyes, it looks, it has faces little round, it has two ears which are doing that, you know. So certain cases, certain algorithms, they give you accurate results, but they cannot explain as to how they came up with that. So such like that, there are many reasons how. And then in clustering, some algorithms can do only disjointed clusters, you know. So in a disjointed cluster, you are either part of A or you are part of B. But there are many practical clusters in life where there is an overlap, you know. So you are 80% A or you are 80% B, or there's a chance that you are 40% A and 60% B. So when you have disjointed clusters, you treat them to be independent, you know. Each group is to be independent, but in practicality, it is not possible. There are many problems where certain clusters are overlapping, you know. So certain algorithms cannot deal with overlapping clusters, you know. So in that case, you have to go for certain type of specialized algorithms, actually, which allows the overlapping clusters. Yeah, there are many criteria like that.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the clarification. Any more queries from participants? So there is a query from Sabina M.
I'm ready. Yeah. If accuracy is achieved using machine learning model for forgery detection, can I use that model or can I go for deep learning? I would say if you are able to achieve good accuracy with statistical machine learning, there is no necessity for you to move into deep learning, because when you move to deep learning, the complexity is much higher, actually. So I would say that if you are able to achieve, see, don't get confused between accuracy and generalization, because accuracy is only a measure. So I have seen cases where practically people say my algorithm is 90% accurate, but when you put into practical use cases, they don't even achieve 40% accuracy. So that is because it is fine for the training data, but it is not fine for the practical use case, you know. So if you are able to achieve a really practically high accurate stuff using machine learning, like statistical machine learning or shallow learning, I would not advise you to go into deep learning just for using deep learning, you know. No, statistical machine learning, there are cases where it is still fine.
Thank you, sir. Any queries? I think it has been clarified, madam. There is one more query from Supriya Manoj. Sir, what is the major difference between deep learning and machine learning? Please mention the advantages of the same.
Yeah. So as I said, machine learning is a general term actually. So within the machine learning, you have statistical machine learning or shallow learning versus deep learning, you know. So if you ask me what is the different relationship between DL and ML, DL is a subset of machine learning, you know. It's a type of machine learning actually. It's a subset of that. What is the advantage? Advantage is that typically if you have more and more data and if your functions are more complex, traditional statistical machine learning is not sufficient. You need to have more complex. So it depends on the nonlinear function that you want to learn, you know. So some of the nonlinear function you want to learn are so complex that preferably you might want a deep learning algorithm and you have a lot of data also available with you, you know. So in which case you use, but as one of the, I think as Supriya or someone asked before, you don't have to use deep learning all the time, you know. So that is, as Sabina asked, you know, you don't have to use deep learning all the time. If you are able to do certain aspect with a good accuracy using statistical machine learning, I would stick with that, you know. Okay, so the next question is, what time test will be?
Sir, it is regarding the online test, sir, regarding the FTP.
Oh, okay.
It's for us. So it will be notified tomorrow, sir. So okay. Any further queries, participants? Shall we wind up the session? So there is a query from Lata M, sir. In deep learning, generally we need more data for accurate results, but for less data, can we able to adapt the deep learning methods for less data?
Yeah, so that is an area of research. There is something called the single shot learning today that's happening. So if you really look at a kid, very young kid, like 2 years, you show them one picture of a cat and tomorrow you show another cat, that kid is able to learn with one example, you know. And typically machine learning, deep learning algorithms are not, if you want to train them on cat, you have to train them on hundreds or thousands of cats. But a human kid is able to learn with one example. So the beauty is that we are able to abstract the concept of a cat so beautifully well that with one or two examples, the kid is tomorrow able to tell that it is a cat. That type of a research is currently happening. So you can look into an area called single shot learning. Single shot learning, this is what they try to achieve, you know. Or one shot learning. So I can put it in the chat. Single shot learning / one shot learning, you know. It's a research area, so there is no perfect answer. I'm assuming as we go over a longer period of time, we will get into, we will start learning with less data also in deep learning, you know.
Yes, thank you, sir. So there is one more query from Pallavi Kulkarni. Any algorithm which is not suitable for multiple faults, say 6 in the machinery, that is any faults with say.
Probably I did not understand the question clearly. So if you can ask directly, you know.
Pallavi Kulkarni, can you please reframe the question because it is not complete. So there is one more query, sir, until unless Pallavi Kulkarni will want to respond. There is one more query from Miri Kra. Sir, do we have data sets available for same probably with respect to the machine learning or the deep learning probably?
Oh, yeah. Today, there are plenty of data sets available. If you search itself, you can get for a lot of things. So if you ask me data set, I would say that today you have probably 500,000 data set available today. That is one of the reasons why this field is advancing very fast. So when companies like Google or companies like Facebook creates a data set, they make that data set available. The problem that today most of us face is that the data sets are so large, 1 terabyte data and all. If you want to process, even some of the best colleges in India can't process. The compute power required to process such data, even IITs and IISCs does not have such computers, you know.
Okay, thank you, sir. So Pallavi Kurkan has reposted the question. Say, like in SVM, it is not suitable for many of the faults. So similarly, can you please classify the faults in a machine? In the sense, is that the certain things which we cannot probably attend on to?
Yeah, so typically, if you look at that, for any problem for that matter, that the type of algorithm you choose actually can differ, you know. So if something is not good with respect to one algorithm, I would suggest you to try a different one, you know. SVM is a reasonably good algorithm, because the reason is that SVM can be applied for many problems. But we'll have to see. SVM is an algorithm in which the feature engineering is done by you. So if the feature engineering to great extent is not good, probably there is a chance that it is not the algorithm that is the problem. It is your feature engineering that is the problem, you know. But that is where deep learning comes into picture, because in deep learning, you don't have to physically do the feature engineering. The algorithm by itself does the feature engineering for you, you know. And it's very, very important, because if you look at a cat, how do you feature engineer a cat? You can say that it has two eyes. But then the question comes is cat only having two eyes? Dogs have two eyes, humans have two eyes. Then you say that it has two ears. Then the question comes is cat the only one which has two ears? No, we have two ears. Dogs have two ears. So cat has two ears. Then the question comes is it has four legs. Now humans are eliminated. We don't have four legs. We have two legs and two hands. But cat has two legs. Dogs have two legs. Other animals have two legs, you know. So feature engineering is very, very important. So because when you feature engineering an image, it is not easy to tell what makes someone understands a cat as cat. There's something different than what it is. Is it eyes? No. There are many animals which have same type of eyes. It's not that color. No, there are cats which are white. There are dogs which are white. But the shape, overall shape, many other things do that. So that feature engineering is very, very important. And I am assuming that probably the issue is not with the SVM algorithm per se, rather it is with the feature engineering that you have performed, you know.
Okay, thank you, sir. Sir, there is one more query from Sharayu Mirasadar. Setting that for natural language processing, which method is preferred, deep learning or the neural networks?
That is where you have to understand. When you say deep learning is actually an extension of neural network, you know. So they are not or. They are actually, deep learning is actually, deep learning also uses neural network only behind the scene. So I would say NLP probably, even though there are statistical machine learning techniques in NLP, NLP requires a lot of data, and hence deep learning methods are more prominently used today in deep learning. Because if you look at NLP, every text is discrete, every word is discrete, you know. So what you are trying to do is that you are trying to find a continuous function over a set of discrete variables, you know. So as I said, when you type something like I am doing, so if you give a sentence like I am doing and ask another person to fill in, typically I am doing fine, I am doing something, you know, so there are many ways you can form that sentence. So in order to convert a discrete into a continuous function, you know, so you need more complex relationships, and probably deep learning is a better technique. And that is why deep learning is a lot used in natural language processing today. But the problem with deep learning is that it requires a lot of data. But today, if you look at the language translations and all, you have like massive data sets available for translating from English to French and other things, you know.
Sir, good evening, sir. I'm having one doubt, sir.
Yeah, sure.
Sir, I am very much interested in research.
Yeah.
In machine learning, in which area is preferable for machine learning, sir? I want to for security point of view.
Yeah. So today, if you look at security, cyber security is a big thing. So in cyber security, there are many areas. So all the way from code reviews. So code review means, you know, sometimes the attackers understand the code and they understand the flaws. So today there are companies which are focused on doing static code analysis and dynamic code analysis to understand whether there is a vulnerability in the code, you know. So that is an area with respect to security. Another area is things like, you know, denial of service attack or distributed denial of service attacks to understand that you are getting attacked by certain players. So that is another area.
Sir, in machine, I want to go for it is on cyber security. Sir, I want to machine learning. So any concept?
All this area you are using machine learning only actually. So when you say static code analysis and dynamic code analysis today, it is actually using machine learning analysis to determine a flaw in your code, you know.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. There are many things. So penetration, then anomaly detection. You know, anomalies are cases where, you know, you see certain IP addresses once in a while coming and then trying to do, you know. So I don't know whether you know, there's something called dictionary-based attacks, you know. In a dictionary-based attack, if your college has a website, what people can do is that you have a website in which case you have certain content which only can be accessed by login people who are logged in. So what they do is that they come to your website, probably your login was based on your email ID and a password. So what they do is that they go through your website, identify your emails, and they use dictionary-based passwords to attack and see whether they can penetrate onto your site, you know. So through using machine learning, you can determine that such attacks are happening and you will have to do time correlation. So here time is an important aspect. These type of attackers they take like 1 month, 2 months to attack onto your system, you know. So by analyzing the IP addresses which are coming to your website over a longer period of time, now you can slowly understand that this IP is coming from a country like Africa and they have no reason to come to our website 200 times in a month, you know, in which case it is a form of attack against your website to see whether they can penetrate into your website or labs and stuff like that, you know. So there are, cybersecurity is a very, very large field. And today, a lot of machine learning is applied in cybersecurity, actually. And there are very dedicated companies on this field.
Okay, sir. So we should move on with our last question of today's session. Mr. Ami Barrett has posted a question stating that research areas of machine learning and deep learning in mechanical engineering domain.
I would say, see, as I said, if you look at that welding and all, that can be applied to both civil engineering and mechanical engineering, you know. So mechanical engineering per se, there are areas like predictive maintenance of machines, you know, like I have a bulldozer, you know, I have a bulldozer which I'm using it and I want to understand whether this bulldozer is ready for transmission. There are many areas. So manufacturing, so if you look at the Tesla manufacturing factory, the entire manufacturing is automated. There are only few manual people in that manufacturing. So during that manufacturing, the defects of parts and many other things are automatically detected, whether my bolt has a problem, whether my bolt is bad or something, you know, or whether my painting has a scratch, you know, and it's a lot of areas where it's used. So what is happening is that we have to move out of this thinking of mechanical engineering versus civil engineering. Today, all the engineering has becoming interdisciplinary in nature, you know. So if you look at today, mechanical cars, so the cars which are using traditional engines, they are getting replaced with electrical engines, you know. So 20 or 30 years down the level, we will not even probably see a diesel car. We will only see an electrical car, you know. So there are many areas you can take a search. You just search for it, you will get it actually. If you have any other thing, you know, you can connect with me in LinkedIn. I can give you hundreds of examples, you know.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your wonderful interaction with the participants, sir, answering all the questions. So we shall meet tomorrow morning, 10 o'clock. So thank you once again, Rajiv, sir. Thank you to your participants for your valuable interaction.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thanks. Have a great day.
Yeah, bye.